I mean, I think Froggen was bad at one point before, but I feel like he's been, I won't say improving, but kind of changing his playstyle a bit. Like, he plays the new champions, he plays melee champions. Like, last year, I think he played Talon, and now he plays more, I don't know, like, he plays every mage in the meta, and, like, mages are not bad, so I think it's not like he got lucky, and that's why he's good, because of the mages, right? I think he just, he knows what's good in the meta, and then he plays it, and then also, I feel like he usually doesn't lose lane, and yeah, I think that's pretty much it.
He knows what's in the meta because he's played through literally all of them. Yeah. One of the most veteran players on the stage. Welcome back to the State Farm Analyst Desk for Game 3, where we've got two powerhouse mid laners loading onto the rip. Potentially two of the best performing mid laners this split in the LCS.
Yeah, I've been really happy with Froggen's claim back to fame. Mm-hmm. I think for a while, being on the stints of his previous teams, he wasn't really able to shine, and now on Dig, he's doing really well.
And Niski has continued his rampage from summer. He was basically the kill leader for mid laners then. I think he's on pace to be again. And he has such an aggressive playstyle. It's not like he has the same one that we've seen out of Jensen and Niski, Jensen, Bjergsen, and Froggen, who have a more controlled playstyle. He is a scrapper. He is down to take dumb fights and try and come out on top, which is something I don't think you've seen traditionally out of North American mid laners who have that all-in playstyle that you see more in LPL and sometimes even in other European mids.
I mean, the dude will pick Veigar and then Flash Cage ult you in the face underneath your inhib turret for a win, so I don't know what you're expected to do against him.
I think he was also the first one to start playing Aatrox mid in North America when it was one of those moments where it's like, North American mids are like, they want to look really good, right? You got like 10 CS a minute, you got like sit KDA, and Niski was kind of the odd man out being like, I'm actually flashing in to start this fight. Yeah. I think that's a really weird like player to play against as well. Because usually you can like track, all right? Support jungle, those are their initiators. Those are the people you need to watch. But when you play against C9, you're like, all right, their top will fight me, their jungle will fight me, their mid's going to fight me. Maybe Sven's going to flash on me now. Like, you don't know what's going to happen.
Even Sven's getting in there, yeah.
So full hype for Niski and the Cloud9 squad. Mm-hmm. Again, they are the only undefeated team remaining in the LCS up against the 3-2 Dignitas. That too in the lost column is the thing I want to look at here for Dignitas, because while Froggen is no slouch, the team itself looks like they're on the precipice of a slide here. If they get another loss, that could be the beginning of a downward trend.
I mean, I'm not going to completely blame coaching staff or anything, but I'm going to say that last draft was not my favorite.
Okay.
Especially because, if you have Froggen in the mid lane, like, I don't know. I've not coached Froggen ever, but I know his champion pool. And I'm sure he can play a lot of things. He played the Aurelia Talon, sure, but those aren't, like, his, like, S-tier picks.
Yeah.
Right? Like, if you want Froggen to perform, he's on a certain set of champions. Sure, he can probably play everything. But if you want like that super high level where he's going to outperform people, you put him on certain champions. I think they've gotten him a lot of really good drafts to play those champions. But recently, they kind of don't give him the space to do that.
Yeah, it's weird because maybe, you can say he's not generally good on AD mids or more like the Assassin-y play style. But you don't have to be playing that way right now. That's why I look at the rest of that draft. When you have the 3 AP top side, you should already be taking an AD in jungle or top if the other one is AP. But then they go double AP, and then they just index it into it even more with Froggen's pick. So it did feel like someone there, maybe it's not Froggen's strength, but he can do it. We've seen him. And that's where I think why it comes down to more of the draft as a whole.
He definitely could. But I do think in that situation, I'd be more likely to look at top lane and Huni as the one who probably should have been playing an AD champion.
Kennen is not.
Well, he has a big champion. He plays a lot of weird things. So I'd be like, Huni, what do you want? You can pick AD. Just go for it.
And I'm not going to.
I mean, Quinn. I don't know.
I don't think. I'm saying.
Oh, no.
Give me the AD Kennen. Why not?
Yeah, AD Kennen, maybe.
You don't need to corral him either. It's just that some. Just acknowledge when it's the bad pick. Sometimes there's crazy good picks, sometimes there's crazy bad. That was one of the latter.
Right. So some criticisms towards the draft. Luckily, draft is one of those things that can be cleaned up by identifying exactly, okay, look, we over-indexed here for AP. Let's not make that mistake again. And if we don't see that today, they're off to a good start. The other person I want to talk about then is Grig, because this is the guy who has to be the glue between those two star, topside solo laners of the map in Huni and Froggen. And if you look at those two losses, it does feel to some degree like he played a role in them.
I think he's been struggling a little bit more than the first three wins that we saw them rip off. He was all over the place with Froggen and playing around Huni. They were moving as a unit. Since they haven't been getting the kind of natural leads, there was a bad matchup versus Bjergsen who was able to get ahead. Then there was the Rumble game versus PoE. It feels like if Froggen isn't already winning his matchup, Grig is not unlocked at all. And that's something there. He needs to be able to make his own plays and not rely on Froggen to jumpstart him.
Yeah, I think he's in kind of a weird spot because Yeah, his lanes have been doing really well. So I think he's been getting away with like kind of suboptimal plays.
Yeah.
But that's kind of where you can't just rely on your team to do that every time. And he needs to be in that spot where he can be the rock. Because a jungler being consistent is pretty much like the most important thing you can do.
And he's going to get tested today.
What yeah, I was going to so say, so the final thing we haven't discussed here is what winning looks like for Dignitas today. Again, Cloud9 has yet to be handed a loss, so we don't even know what losing looks like for that team. But I more want to attack it from the Dignitas side. Where's the hole in Cloud9's game that Dignitas is geared to exploit?
I mean, I still think Dig has really strong teamfight potential, especially going into later game. It looks like as the game progresses and they start grouping, they are usually on the same page with a lot of things. So I think if they can survive the laning phase well, or even like come out with a lead, I think their mid-game looks pretty solid, comparable to C9. Although C9 is obviously cleaner, faster, and just stronger overall. I think that's where Dig can actually match up.
I think I would be curious which approach they go for. I could see one where you say, okay, we're really good with stable play, with Frog and, you know, absorbing some of this pressure that's probably going to come from Niski and Blabber. And maybe they try and go late game with GP for Huni, and they go back to that kind of more scaling approach with a Victor or Orianna or something. But I also wouldn't mind seeing them go really scrappy around top lane and try and get ahead of Licorice and actually outfight Blabber and Licorice, because they will make mistakes. They admit that they go really hard. And if you catch them out once, you can maybe keep driving that home.
Here's my question. Were they watching LCS Countdown earlier? We went over all of those brilliant dives.
They don't want to go top. They don't want to be on the show.
They don't want to submit their own entrance.
Clips making it onto the show.
They're going to avoid this 2v1 dives.
All right, well, again, that featured matchup, mid lane Frog and our MasterCard Player of the Week from week one up against Niski in the mid lane for the undefeated Cloud9. The teams are heading into Champion Select, so let's see what they draft themselves as we head out to Captain Flowers and Azale for game three.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. I am Clayton Captain Flowers Reigns, but unfortunately, Isaac had some real life problems come up today. He's taking care of that. Sam Kobe Hartman Kinsler gonna be filling in on the desk for him. What a team player.
Yeah, I've decided to quit jungle. I'm playing Phil now, Captain Flowers.
What? Surprise! A hero in all your solo queue games and mine, except probably not, because he's higher elo than all the rest of us put together. But let's go ahead, jump into the game now, see who's going to be playing, what they're going to be doing. It's Elise, Irelia, Set, banned out by Dignitas, Cloud9. They'll take Akali, Lucian, and Rumble out of the pool, as the first pick for Dig is the Kench.
Yeah, Tahm Kench already here for Dig. So trying to get that safety early on. Cloud9 has been our most dominant team in the LCS. Fastest games, picking off kills everywhere. They play their lanes extremely aggressively. So Dig are trying to get somewhere safe to rely on the map. They're hoping bottom lane will be their safety point, it looks like, with the Tahm Kench plus Senna. Fairly defensive.
And that was a very fast lock-in on the Gangplank there as well. So you've got your top laner and your bottom lane locked in for Dignitas. Cloud9's gonna do the same. Aphelios, Nautilus, Aatrox all picked up.
Yeah, honestly, this is looking like Dig on defense, Cloud9 on offense for this game, because there's no hesitation. These are insta-locks as well. Licorice, you know, Aatrox has been, throughout the years that he's been on Cloud9, one of his most dominant champions. People always remember all these big Aatrox flanks where he's coming from behind blue buff, circling around people on Dragon, and Aatrox into Gangplank should allow him to get to that point, couple items, and become that juggernaut that he can try and play for the flanks. Meanwhile, we're targeting junglers now, as both teams have yet to lock one in. So they're trying to take away a couple of the damage options. AP damage options being taken away by Dig with the Gragas and maybe Elise to follow. AD options being taken away by Cloud9.
Olaf taken out of there as well. Very adept at dueling in the jungle, controlling things early on, roaming around with a mid laner. He won't be in this one. But man, Cloud9 has the opportunity here to be 6-0 after 3 weeks of play. So very, very scary, this team.
They also have the opportunity to be 5-1.
Yes, I see you're looking at things from the Dignitas point of view, which is exactly where they'd love to put Cloud9. LeBlanc will be the final ban of the second phase here. Let's see how C9 wants to proceed.
Yeah, all right. Also, they have to worry about how are we going to keep Sven deathless? Because he's on Aphelios, a champion with no defenses, no dashes, and they've drafted an offensive lane partner for him with the Nautilus. So, like we were talking about, Cloud9 always looking for kills, looking to be proactive, and they get Blabber the Lee Sin to try and start that out. Rek'Sai is one of my favorite picks into Lee Sin, a lot of people's favorite picks into Lee
Sin. Works really well.
Because it's very easy to actually pull off the counter. You know, unburrowing is click of the mouse
you,
there.
You click the guy. Yes. There's not a lot of mechanical outplay involved there. But the mid laner for Dignitas, it's going to be Froggen on Orianna, and the matchup will be Zoe for Niski.
I do also like the prevalence of Zoe. I mean, holistically and theoretically, I don't like it, you know, as a champion.
Right, yeah.
We're not big Zoe fans.
Morally, you're opposed, but...
But it really does well in the current meta, in my opinion, because so much is focused on taking down these outer turrets early and finding areas for Zoe to throw these bubbles over. So we'll see, especially with Blabber and Niski, they've combined super well for some mid-jungle synergy, and Lee Sin, Zoe can definitely try and prey on Orianna. We saw already Dignitas yesterday. They drafted the Vel'Koz for Froggen. Bjergsen just completely bullied him. Even though he didn't get solo kills, he solo forced Froggen out of lane multiple times, which earned TSM objectives uncontested from Dig because they didn't have mid priority.
And Dignitas had a lot of hype coming out of week one. They looked really good. In week two, then they lose one, win one. So everybody's still like, okay, but obviously the is Dignitas going to win Worlds meme conversation stop a little bit there after they get the first loss. But this team has been looking better than people might have initially expected. The thing is, though, you're going up against Cloud9, which seem to be playing in a league of their own after these first five games. C9 played against FlyQuest yesterday, which, remember, is the team that smashed Dignitas last week. Can Cloud9 now find that one? What will happen sooner? First death or pizza delivery Sivir cosplay? Well, he said the Sivir cosplay is never happening, but yeah. At this rate, he's never dying either, so we'll have to see.
I feel like people are going to never stop asking for it, too, so he's going to have to keep on denying it.
Well, as long as he keeps not dying, he'll have something to stand on, right? He's got a strong foundation.
All right. Well, Dignitas, that's going to be goal number one for them, because that is always your point of operations here. Take down the Aphelios. You can take down the team.
And he doesn't have a Thresh or a Tahm Kench or one of those supports that specifically is designed to keep him alive. No Braum. Nautilus is much more of, I'm just going to go in, team fight, CC, engage. So we'll see how well Sven can position here.
But have you thought of this? Your opponents cannot kill you if you kill them first.
Ah, I see. The best defense is a good offense.
We got a lot in the audience. That's a good
Yeah, the five head. You're enlightening some people here.
Paradigm shift here, Captain Flowers.
Ooh,
best defense is indeed a good offense. Vulcan, by the way, talking about supports and talking about setting up your AD carries, he has performed very, very admirably thus far in the season. They released a couple stories. I know there was ESPN talking about how heavily the teams were fighting over this guy and what it took to get him on Cloud9. I think he's definitely doing the fans justice thus far.
And last year on Clutch, he was the guy who would always be starting things off. He would have some really bad games and some really good games, but they would always come from the same ballpark. It was always him going in. It was whether or not the engage was at the right time and coordinated with everyone else. But this Cloud9 team has just seemed to be on the same page here in the first few weeks of 2020, and it's been a lot of fun to watch.
All right, I will say, from the Dignitas point of view here, Huni also had a very good Gangplank game. And this is one of the champions throughout Huni's career that people have been very worried about giving him. Because he is so good on the Gangplank, he puts out a lot of DPS. And if you watch him play the champion later on in the game, one of the big differences between him and a lot of other Gangplanks is that Huni is not afraid to get in there and use the Gangplank auto attacks. A lot of Gangplanks will just sit back, look for barrel chains later, you know, play it super defensively with the rest of the team. But Huni goes for maximum DPS output utilizing the passive of Gangplank, getting in for extra autos, using aggressive flashes so that he can secure those kills for the team. And that's one of the things that really does separate the greats.
And I really like the Gangplank on a team with Senna as well. Provides a lot of difficulty for your opponents trying to engage onto barrels and onto Senna's mist, while at the same time creating another big late-game damage threat through the AD lens. Considering Senna doesn't quite have the same DPS, the attacks are very slow. It's a boom-boom with the auto attack and the Q. But Gangplank can really make that explode on the next level here. You can see the junglers might find each other. Blabber remaining perfectly still, so Grig can't see him with the Tremor Sense.
I actually love... Oh, bubble does land. Blabber's gonna get him.
There we go. They're looking to go in. Grig taken out first. Blood.
Do we say in Champ Select the mid-jungle synergy for Cloud9 has been off the charts, Flowers? Because There you go. Niski does not hesitate to come over. Soon as Griggs starts clearing that ward, Cloud9 in full attack mode. Full attack mode also looks like standing still when you're fighting either a Rek'Sai or a T-Rex.
Perfectly motionless.
A Rek'Sai or a T-Rex, it's the same deal. Flapper stops.
T-Rex-Sai.
As soon as Grig goes up, Niski lands that bubble. That was such a good bubble over this wall, by the way, fighting the full distance just to hit Grig with the end of it there. And a very quick first blood in this game gets them off to a place that Cloud9 will be so happy about, because Zoe with early kills affects everybody. This is not an, oh no, my mid lane matchup is slightly harder now. This is everybody has to worry about bubbles flying over the wall at all points. Zoe's actually very good at roaming, especially since Cloud9 have achieved the double scuttle.
Yes.
The dream scenario for your early game, which allows you to traverse the entire Summoner's Rift, look for those roams, and look to affect the other reigns. Grig wants to get back out and create something positive for the team. Licorice, though, giving a lot of respect to Huni's Barrel Chains.
Very much being paid here, and that means Grig will not be able to find that opportunity he's looking for. And with Niski currently out of vision for the side of Dignitas, they have to pull back, because if you overcommit to something top and the bubble is there, you are quickly going to find yourselves on the losing end of a fight. Niski now back into the mid lane. Licorice feels a little more comfortable up in the top side. And you'll see in bottom lane here is Vin pushing up. Look at the Sorcerer's Shoes already done there for Niski.
Yeah, I want to highlight here. Top
side. Over the wall, Blabber tries to make the moves. Huni's going to be forced away from this turret. Redemption coming down. It's like an artillery strike. He's not going to find the kill. But Grig is now in danger. Flash still available, gets himself away, but that's two flashes burned and about two minion waves completely eaten up by a turret.
And this game has kind of encapsulated what C9 have been doing to the entire LCS. They see someone and they just start slapping them, send them back to base. They don't get any kills there, but they are able to force them down and off of the turret there, losing some minions, forcing them back to base, retaining control of Summoner's Rift. What I was trying to highlight there earlier, though, was the Sork Shoes early purchase from Niski. That's what he spent that first blood money on. And it goes to back on my point that I was talking about roaming for this Zoe. If the Zoe gets that early money and you're able to retain control of those scuttle crabs throughout the game, you get kind of get your highway open of the river pathway, where Niski starts moving around the lanes. He's invading the jungle right now and getting extra vision for C9.
Niski always going to be a threat on this champion, facilitating those plays here around the bottom side. You can see the Drake is up 6 minutes in. Sometimes we do see those attempted here pretty early on if the team does have a lead. Bottom side is where the second Scuttle Crab is going to spawn. You can see Blabber is already there to be able to pick that one up when it does show. Sven rotating up into the river along with Vulcan here, and they'll have control over that Mountain Drake pit and start it up.
Yep, Control Ward goes down. Mountain Drake, the lowest DPS dragon as well, so at least he has zero problem tanking that up with safeguards. See if Grig actually goes for anything here. They do Prey Seeker, but they're a little bit late for the steal.
Oh, but they're not too late to potentially get caught out. Dignitas doing a good job disengaging. Blabber down to half HP, has to run back. Root comes out. CC is down. Sleepy Trouble, there's the bubble. Aframu's going to sleep, and it is night-night. Vulcan grabs the kill.
Niski, not only does he land the bubble over the wall to snipe the sleep onto Aframu and allow the cooldown for Vulcan's hook to come back up, but he also predicts the flash from Aframu with his Q placement, kills him upon arrival, and it's starting to come true, Flowers. Even though the kill did technically go over to Vulcan and he gets the extra money.
Still counts.
Still counts, and C9 very happy to get the extra leeway here. Let's take another look. So, Dragon goes down, Vulcan looks for the engage, they get the Devour out super early on, so they go for the harassment, and just like we're talking about on that minimap, you see, it is the mid lane roam from Niski. He lands this bubble over the wall, and then look at his Q. He already is placing it this way, towards where Aframu is going to flash. So even though he does afterwards, still gets him on the kill.
I don't know what you're doing there as Dignitas. Obviously, you're not gonna go in and fight for that Drake because Grig's already used flash. If he goes in, he's dead 100%, even if he gets it. It seemed like a breakdown in communication there. Froggen never even moved to follow. They knew Niski was gonna go. Just not what Dignitas needs to be doing against a team that's gonna snowball the game like Cloud9.
Yep, when you your opponents are stronger than you and have better positioning on an objective, in the early game, you don't try and contest it if the opportunity is not there, right? You try and create something on the other side of the map. But Dig have been just full defense levels thus far in the game. Right now, they're finally getting an answer here. Sleepy Trouble Bubble does land, and the Rift Veil getting low.
Aframu does a good job there blocking for Frog and making sure no more damage is coming in. Labyrinth found the Sonic Wave, kick into the Resonating Strike. Good Lord, man, Greg is gone. Shelly is stolen. Blabber will fall. That's a one for one on junglers. Cloud9 now trying to disengage. Gangplank ulti coming down, bringing the fire, but that is a one fight for the side of C9, and Aframu might be yet another trophy. Damage comes in, Moonlight Vigil gonna provide some extra DPS. The Chakram's not quite enough. Sven's got a whole orbit of those things around him as Huni continues to walk away back into the top side.
Blabber is creating some highlight reels here, my friend.
Yeah.
He goes in, not only does he get the kill on the enemy jungler within his own team, but in the end, Cloud9 walk away with pretty much all the resources here. So, gonna have a reset for Dignitas, and they really need to take a deep breath because look at the way this game is going. Vulcan does get the hook afterwards onto Orianna. Blabber goes in, 100% to zero. Grig there, then steals the Rift Herald as well. Even though he goes down to the Senna ultimate, his job is done. He killed his opponent and took the objective. They then retreat off of the Gangplank ultimate before re-engaging to push them off of Summoner's Rift and back to the base.
And we'll see how that Rift Herald gets used by the side of Cloud9. We've been talking a lot this split about how teams like to knock off the first couple of plates and then use it to take down the rest of the turret for maximum value. And there we go. One plate down, almost through that second one. A little bit more. There we go. Shelly just ringing in the bank for Cloud9.
Talk to me about the feeling of being in range of a Rift-Tailed smashed on turret plates, by the way, because that cha-ching.
Oh, one of the best in the game.
It's one of a very satisfying noise. I feel like they really nailed it on the audio.
The
audio feedback for that feels real nice.
Well, everything feels real nice in the early game here for C9. Nice bubble lands its way out of Froggen, who uses the Shockwave in combination with a Cleanse to get the better of Niski there. But that is a summoner spell expended. Niski will just head home and heal up as Blabber shows up into the lane to cover for him. Vulcan also sitting down some vision in the enemy jungle to make sure they're very aware if somebody's coming top to gank's Vin.
Okay, we talk about Dignitas need to take a deep breath. They need to refocus here because Cloud9 have been running this game so far. They do have Huni on Gangplank scaling on bottom side with the teleports for both bottom laners coming back up here. He's trying to scale up, and he's actually had to delay the build a little bit here and stop off for the Executioners because it helps him both in the 1v1 with Aatrox for the extra healing reduction to try and find superiority in the side lanes. And it's going to delay his Trinity Force a little bit, so you're not going to get the bigger barrel chains coming through for teamfights quite as quickly. And that really does put more emphasis for Dignitas on really trying to stop the bleeding here as Cloud9 keep pushing the tempo of this game. Problem is, in the current state, with so many objectives popping up, double Rift Heralds, dragons all stacking up towards Seoul, there very quickly is always a new neutral objective for the team that is ahead to try and force on. And Cloud9, keep it up.
Oh, Licorice being collapsed on here on the bottom side, but Blabber has shown up, the counterattack comes through, and Grig is once again on the run. Dignitas tries to make the plays. Ho, ho, ho! He had to feel that one just singe the hairs on the back of his neck. Huni walks away, but the Paddle Star nearly finds him.
A little bit wide there. C9 come to Licorice's defense and get him out alive. Dig's still kicking. Let's see what they can do with it here. Froggen trying to hold on to that mid lane. Because of the Rift Trail, there's only small amount of HP left on it. One turret blade. And Froggen has to work off of, and they really need to keep that mid turret standing. When your mid turret goes down, it opens up your entire jungle to invades. And that is just so devastating when you're facing a Zoe. So, big goal right now for Cloud9 is taking this point of power away from Dig, removing their mid lane defense with the last little bit of that outer tower.
Two things Dignitas got going for him. Froggen has much better farm than Niski does.
Run for the hill.
But Hooney's in a lot of trouble here. Licorice, Blabber, Niski, the whole goon squad showed up. And that's easy money for them. They'll be able to push onto this turret now as well. Still 40 seconds left to get plate money.
Now, look at the big CS discrepancy that is opening up. Because Niski roams to every single fight, that is the payment. Now, I would say that payment is worth it to have this Zoe roaming around getting all these kills for Cloud9. But you have to count, what is Dig getting back for it? Froggen pushes in again there. Not only does he get the minion wave, he also got a turret plate. Licorice will achieve even better on bottom side though, so it's that's why the meta right now is to remain proactive. And mid laners have been constantly roaming ever since Doin B and FBX kind of showed them the light in, at Worlds.
Many lessons were learned in those times, but
the CS numbers though, those are there for later.
Well, but the thing is, you also got to consider that is the one lane where the CS numbers are benefiting the side of Dignitas. Look at the other three. You've got a 30 CS lead for Licorice over Hooney. The jungle's even a lead for Blabber over Grig, despite the fact that Blabber has been all over every single play for C9. Bottom side Sven also farming up better on that Aphelios. So Cloud9 is making sure that they're getting benefits across the map for Niski making those sacrifices. As you said, top lane turret falls on the side of Dignitas. That is the first turret of the game going down. And C9, 14 and a half minutes into this game, nearly 3,000 gold ahead of Dig.
Yep, well earned by them. And look at this build from Sven as well. He went full flat attack damage there before the combination on the Essence Reaver. Looked especially cool with the double long swords and BF swords sitting there. But now that the Essence Reaver is done, he's ready for the team fight as well. See if they can actually find more picks. Niski's holding onto a ghost with Zoe, which is very useful actually for repositioning for those bubbles.
Remember that when Zoe uses the stolen abilities through summoner spells, item actives, whatever, she gets a quick burst of speed too. And Ghost, it has a moment at the beginning where it has to accelerate. You're not as fast as you would be throughout the rest of the duration of the spell. So considering those two combined together, it means that the movement speed makes up for it and she's just running like a bat out of hell.
Yeah, the Zoe Ghost is off of W is more like Mario Kart when you hit the perfect ignition on start and you get that nice boost.
Just a little bonus. Well, either way, he'll be fast as long as he's got that. Redemption now locked and loaded too. Pretty big team fight power up there. Next, Drake is going to be spawning just 60 seconds from now. Cloud9 with two already in their possession means it will put the game on soul point if they get this third. Dignitas, they know they're pretty far behind, but do they want to even try to fight for that? Aphromoo loses 3/4 HP from that Zoe combo, and Niski will shove him back. That's going to get C9 priority over the mid lane, priority over that Rift Herald pit. And with Sven and Blabber working together to take that one down, that is Shelly number two of this game going over to the C9 side.
It's actually so ridiculous too when Zoe gets redemptions. He's not worried at all about the back half of that trade where, oh, Johnson's gonna hit me with a Q because I go in for this big trade on Aphromoo. Just heal back up the full with your own redemption that he's able to pick up. And there it is. That last defense we were talking about with the mid turret for Dignitas just went down. C9 now can use this priority, setting up for the dragon. This is number three, setting up for an infernal, and they should be able to take it here. Harassment being pelted out.
One important thing to remember is when Lee Sin has Rift Herald, if a team fight breaks out, he can't ward hop because he has no trinket. Blabber does find the Sonic Wave onto Grig. Turret placed down by Aphelios. Sven trying to just zone their opponents away. Dignitas do not have any priority over this fight. It's going to be Cloud9 moving into the bottom lane river.
All right, let's see. Can Dig get a big shockwave? Because that's what it's going to have to be if they're actually going to fight over this. They've got to get the ball to somebody who can place it for Froggen.
You can see Blabber summons Shelly. She'll just walk into the bottom lane, and now he has the trinket ready to go if he needs to ward hop to it. Licorice hanging out on the backside of the pit. Look at the damage. With Johnson down to 100 HP, Dignitas, they have to retreat.
No fight left in him. You get sniped down like that, you have to give it up. This, thankfully at least for Dig, is not the actual soul, but the actual soul is coming pretty quick. 5 minutes, start the timer, Flowers.
That's a potential 22-minute Infernal Soul for the side of Cloud9 that is already just exploding into the Rift this game. Shelly gets that bottom lane turret for them as well. That's all three outer turrets taken down from the Dignitas side, and Cloud9 just feels so much more comfortable pushing even further into that territory now. You were already talking about how mid lane turret opens up the map, but when they don't have the sides to run to either, Cloud9 will be looking for those picks.
Very true. Licorice already starting off with some of the split pushing down on bottom side. He has the defensive wards already in place in the red side jungle and the red buff on top of it. So he feels very confident pushing up here, even though Cloud9 hadn't pushed the other lanes as quickly. Now they've got Sven and Vulcan up there on top side, Niski getting into the mid. So C9 can push them all out and then collapse on Grig, who's going for a risky scuttle.
Grig finally wants to get himself a crab this game. He's been deprived of so many. He will manage to secure that one and get out just in the nick of time.
Crab meat can be very pricey. Flowers. I don't know if you
yes.
go to the grocery store a lot, but especially if your team is behind, the price just goes through the roof.
I hate going to the grocery store and my team's behind. It's one of the worst feelings.
It's really dangerous, you know.
Well, Dignitas are going to be playing this game from the back foot here for a while. Still need plenty of time to scale up these carries. Hooney still without the Trinity Force completed. God. Just now got that one done. And Johnson is having a very Zoe experience right now.
Oh man, with the corrupting potion too, that thing's ticking down. He got into double digit health right there. Almost gonna bite it, but Niski with the blue buff on Zoe too can just keep throwing him out. Honestly, the Baron can't spawn quick enough for C9. The crab meat, the expensive crab meat is well purchased there by Grig. He took the risk and that's gonna give them some solid vision. Because without that, you have to be so freaking scared face checking into Fog of War against the Zoe that's already doing that to your AD carry.
And look at the vision. Look at the Cloud9 wards in the top half of the Dignitas jungle. It is just red, 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 red. They have this whole thing lit up, and Dignitas has to just inch their way forward. Super scared. They're in a horror movie right now trying to peek around the corner.
Yeah.
Except the monster's even scarier because it's Zoe.
Yeah, definitely a lot of red energy coming out of Niski here from the mid lane, too. See if he can find a snipe here. He keeps backing off towards the control wards, out of vision. This is what you want to do. They're so far ahead, they have full vision superiority for C9. So he just keeps on dropping back into Fog of War, looking, fishing around for possible picks. Grig here doing his part, though. Fighting that fight for the vision, trying to give them some sort of early alert if the Baron does get started up.
Stand strong, soldier. You gotta hold this line. Except now you're gonna lose the frog.
Oh, is he though? Grig, still around. This is fight.
Of all the things to fight for, I don't think a frog is the
one. You don't fight over, you go for the smite still.
Okay.
If you have two charges only, by the way.
Well, Dignitas might be able to make some sort of a pick here. Sven with the flash over the wall. Froggen could not get him with the shockwave, but now the counterattack comes through. TP coming in, Aphromoo taken very low. Grig gonna be going into the ultimate, keeping himself alive only for a moment longer. Licorice tanks up, buys the time they need to grab that pick and gets out safely. The crab has respawned, this time secured by Cloud9. It's a 1-0 trade for them.
Double summoners blown by Sven there to keep his KDA alive. And it does come at the cost of Grig's life. But honestly, if there are no summoners on Aphelios and Zoe, the carries here for Cloud9, maybe there's a possibility for Dig. Hooney has finally gotten his Trinity Force completed for the Gangplank, so you can have a decent backline threat. Again, Froggen looking for a game-winning shockwave for them. It is going to be super difficult because they don't have a great delivery system, right? Rek'Sai is not that quick at getting in, and Grig himself used Flash in the last play, which would be the surprise factor that Dig could try and hope for a comeback in this game. Without that, it's going to have to be sneaky ball placement from Froggen to try and find his own. Otherwise, Cloud9, Soul is approaching. 20 seconds on Infernal Soul, and C9 very happy to set it up here.
Dignitas is going to have to work a miracle here, get some sort of big fight, big pick, to buy themselves enough time to prevent that soul from coming online. We're just about 23 minutes in, Drake about to spawn. It's Dignitas with priority over the river, and Blabber chunked down to half HP by the Dignitas roster. Licorice is coming around from the other side. It could be a pincer maneuver from Cloud9.
Krish walks up, Hoonies at 3/4 HP, Paddle Star. Next onto Frog on an Aphra move, finds a little bit of damage there. Licorice trading aggressively onto Hoonie, forces the flash out of the Dignitas top lane.
Definitely a valuable cooldown here for this very important team fight. Infernal Soul could be game breaking for Dig. Ori gets devoured, and that's going to be a long cooldown.
Very good devour there from Aphra move, making sure Froggen doesn't get chunked away. C9 have decided to start up the Drake. Remember, you could always have the smite fight. I think this is one that you always risk if you're Dignitas. Grig thinking about it. Gangplank ulti already summoned up. Cloud9 playing this slowly. Very nice shockwave onto Toon!
They got him!
And Froggen gets the first kill of the split onto Sven. But at what cost? Dignitas is annihilated by Cloud9.
Infernal Soul picked up for C9. The reign of Lord Spennington has come to an end. He has died, but there's a caveat, Captain Flowers.
Oh, do tell, my good man.
If you only have one death, you're still only dividing by one, so technically your KDA doesn't go down.
You get one freebie.
Yeah, exactly. So he did die. He's not deathless anymore, but at least his KDA is intact still. And it should come with a C9 victory now because they have Infernal Dragon. And look at that. We were talking about, can Froggen find the shockwave to change the game? He does find the shockwave to kill the carry, but it doesn't change the game.
No.
Because C9 still kill everyone except for Grig, and they still get the Infernal Soul.
And Grig had no way to even try to steal that. His smite wasn't ready. He had no tunnel.
He threw the Prey Seeker. That's his way.
Okay, sure. All right. Toss a Prey Seeker in the pit. Hope for the best. But Cloud9 is now 6,000 gold up. They've got themselves an Infernal Soul pre-25 minutes. Everything is looking phenomenal here for this squad, and I can only expect they're going to be setting up vision more and more in this top side of the Dignitas jungle and prepping for Baron.
Oh yeah, you've got Infernal Soul, you have a Zoe, you have vision control over Baron. These are all the things that you need.
This checklist is adding up.
Yeah, and talk about vision control, we could just highlight this a little bit. It's dangerous right now. The jungle is dark and full of terrors for Team Dignitas here. They're rushing into it though, Aphra Moon Greek. Trying to go get some vision while C9 have a reset.
You know, now that you mentioned the Dark and Full of Terrors, League of Legends is kind of like Dignitas is kind of like the Dothraki in Season 8 because they all died, but now they just randomly reappeared again.
Okay.
Respawn time.
Just charge straight onto that battlefield.
Yeah, just charge out in there. Be your best self. Live your best life. But Cloud9, they've got themselves the game in the palm of their hands, man. It is up to them to lose. I think it's legitimately out of Dignitas's control now, whether or not Cloud9 loses this game. It's up to C9 to make some sort of an error, but it doesn't look like that's going to happen here just yet. Johnson's under pressure. Licorice forces him to flash away. Shockwave is going to whiff. That's a whole lot of nothing, and that's way too important of a spell. C9 knows it, and they're pushing onto the tier two.
Yeah, no ultimates there. That was also the Gangplank ultimate. The theory right there for Dig, they try to use GP ult to slow Licorice enough that he stays in range of the shockwave, and it was pretty close, but close is not going to cut it in this game. You need a huge miracle to come back. So without GP and Orianna ultimates, your team fight has zero power behind it, and C9 will take the Baron. Grig, can he throw a Prey Seeker, thread the needle through everyone?
That would be the greatest Prey Seeker of all time.
It actually
just
would.
Saying. I'm pretty sure there's legitimately just no way. Vulcan's gonna buy some time for these guys. He's got the stone plate, keeping him tanky. There on the front line, Blabber goes over the wall, and he is unstoppable. Hoonie now gonna be soaking all the damage from Niski off to the side of this fight. Soaking, well, it's a waterfall. You ain't gonna soak that up. That's so much damage from Cloud9, and they're right back on the Baron.
Yep, they peel off there quick for the turn as Vulcan goes in. Hooks into the wall. That's going to be two more kills from C9 and the Baron. And this is looking like a Baron power play that might end with a Nexus kill, my friend.
We could very easily see this game end under 30 minutes. One big push from Cloud9 to take Dignitas down.
Let's take a look. Even though he doesn't hit the champion, he hooks the wall there for Vulcan, so he's in the fight. He gets the ult there to secure a kill onto Rek'Sai when Blabber goes in on Lee Sin. And you're talking about the waterfall on the left side of your screen there. Niski is able to drown him.
And one thing I'd like to point out, right after the Baron is taken, Niski says, you know what? Yeah, this game's over. Medjai's Soul Stealer. He's got the Book of BM in his inventory.
So
This is his death note. He's writing their names.
Here's my perspective on it, though. It's not really BM if you're this far ahead, because you're getting kills too. He's got it stacked up. It's actually efficient.
Mm-hmm. But whenever I see an opponent build the book, I know I'm being BM.
The BM to me is buying it early, before your team is ahead. This is the difference to me between trash talking before the game and trash talking after the game. This is trash talking after the game.
Okay.
He's like, we're so far ahead. I'm gonna buy a Soul Stealer. Ha ha, gotcha. No, if you go back, first buy, you upgrade your ring into
Instead of Sorcerer's Shoes, he buys a book. Yeah. That's the play.
Because that buy is telling them, you're so bad, I am gonna stomp you without stats. I'm gonna stack up this book.
I feel like that buy is saying, please gank me.
Exactly. And it says, even if you gank me, I'm gonna outplay.
I'll outplay you. Okay, fair enough. Well, Cloud9, they aren't worried about ganks or anything anymore. They're so well set up in this game. Sven's pushing up the bottom lane. They've got the Baron for another minute and 15 seconds. And they've got the mid lane inhibitor turret down to half HP. Bottom lane nearly the same. Hooney doing what he can with those barrels to try to just clear these waves out. Frayseeker finds its way onto a cannon mini, but it's so hard for Dignitas to actually kill these things. More damage coming through. Moonlight Vigil not going to get a whole lot done there, though. But the mid lane inhibitor turret does fall. Licorice, Nisqy, and Blabber pushing up as a three-man unit, pressuring onto the inhib itself now. Dignitas trying to handle them 3v3, but no fair fight will go Dignitas's way in this game. Cloud9 have now broken the second inhibitor turret. First inhibitor falls, second one's in their sights. Sven continues applying the auto attacks with the Infernum, getting the extra splash if anybody stands too close. And C9 have two inhibs for free. And Kobe, there's a big old laser dragon spawning here in about 3 seconds. And if Cloud9 so chooses, they can go get that before the end of the game.
Yeah, Baron's running out right now. They only got a few more seconds with it left on. So the push will come to a halt. For me, it's actually, well, they're just going to instantly take it before it starts to get there. So you know what? No analysis needed. It's just too easy. They have so much damage. You burn it down. The game is waiting to be executed here. Dig lying in wait inside their base. You've got a lot of homework delivered to you. It's super minion duty. Got them streaming in through two lanes.
3 minutes of Elder Drake buff. And look at the timers, almost perfectly synced. As soon as Elder expires, Baron is up. So somehow, if Dignitas managed to weather this storm, you've now immediately got another problem right after.
Or, how about this?
Okay.
If they make the miracle happen.
The ultimate optimist?
Yeah.
They manage to ace them at the end.
Yeah, they wait for the Elder Dragon about to time out, then they find the miracle fight, then they get a Baron reward. You gotta throw in some M. Night Shyamalan style twist in your story.
You gotta have the hardiest, strongest plot armor in the world to survive that. But maybe they can. Maybe they can do it. This is a squad that impressed people. Like I said, in those first three games, things have been a little shakier since with the loss of the FlyQuest and TSM. Cloud9 now looking to put another one in the L column for Team Dignitas as they push up. Licorice trying to make the moves. Remember, you get somebody to 20% HP, they are gone. The Dragon Breeze, the laser, and they're back in the fountain. Cloud9 pushing onto that last remaining Tier 2 turret. They'll take it down. Now the final inhib is the target. Infernal Soul, Elder Drake, a massive 11,000 gold lead. Grig may very well just die here. He's at 80% and he knew he had to stasis or he dies to that sleepy trouble bubbles.
Yeah, I agree. You don't wanna go in your sleep, so go into gold mode. Survives to see another day, to see one more push. Licorice is behind them. The tower still standing, but it doesn't matter.
Vulcan's going in. Johnson's under pressure. Blabber looking to grab the damage into the execution. He is dominating. Hooney's in the back line, and the dragon is just breathing fire on all of Dignitas. It's a double for Nisqy, and it's an absolute slaughter for Cloud9. Dig will lose their remaining inhibitor. They will lose their Nexus turrets. And they will lose their third game here in spring 2020. Cloud9 pushing onto the Nexus now itself. They go for the dive, they make it happen, and they are 6-0.
So, you know how all the pro players call anything that is good smurfing now?
Like
they just apply that term to anything positive?
Yeah.
Like Cloud9 actually legitimately look like they are a Smurf team in the LCS with how they've dominated the beginning here. Like, the beginning of spring has been C9 in a league apart almost.
You know what it reminds me of? Watching play-in teams play against major regions at an international event. Mm. Everybody else is a play-in team, and Cloud9 is old school SKT. And they're just saying, all right, line up, and we're gonna knock y'all down. This team has been so much fun to watch. They are playing so well together, and they're just playing some damn fine League of Legends. 19 stacks when the dust settles on Niski's Soul Stealer. Sven, as you said, finally, one in the death column there for him.
But as you said, you divide by zero. You can't really do that, but it's, right. It's the same as dividing by one. So his KDA remains intact. Yeah, gotta jiggle the numbers a little bit.
Yeah. We just gotta finagle some things. But I'm pretty sure with 7 assists, he went 0-1-7 that game. I think that takes him up to a 70 KDA now, 70, okay. 71, something like that.
The mark to his, by the way, with the record is Chovy from the LCK mm-hmm. with 104.
104 is what I knew. It was over 100. I didn't know how far over it was specifically. So he's got to get another 33 or 34 without dying.
Yeah, once. Now he actually cannot die.
No more deaths are allowed. So that's the high bar Sven is going to have to aim for. But with the team that he's playing on right now, in the interview we heard from him yesterday that he did with Ovaly, he said, yeah, I'm not just playing better than I have in the last 2 years. I'm playing better on a team that's this good. And that's an awesome thing to hear when your guy who's popping off every single game says, no, it's not just me. This is the whole squad. Like, this is five-man pop-off unit. But now we're going to send things down to Latigris, who is standing by for an interview with Cloud9's victorious mid laner.
Well, of course, I did have to get some words from Niski after that performance, but it is a team effort indeed. First things I want to hear from you is, going into this, many had the question of, how much was it Svenskir and how much was it Niski during the last season? I think it's safe to say you've proven yourself so far. So what do you make of the new dynamic with the permanent partnership with Blaber?
I think after last year, I feel like me and Svenskir were actually really good during the summer split, so this year, I really wanted to make sure that Blaber kind of, I won't say was as good as Svenskir, but even better, because Blaber's early game is actually really insane. And if I can control him, or if the team can control him in mid game, then he's just, yeah, one of the best junglers for sure.
Now, I thought I was going to come into this interview and tell you, oh, you still have the entirety of your games played without a gold deficit. Technically got broken this game, but overall still as solid of a performance as some others. So does this pose any issues as far as how to practice when you do have to eventually maybe come from those behind situations?
I cannot really tell right now because, I mean, we're usually not behind, so like the issue doesn't come. But I feel like in practice, sometimes we're behind and we really try to get as much as we can out of it because we're usually not behind, right? So yeah, I think whenever we're behind in practice, if we keep going like this, then even if we're behind, we can always come back from games.
Now, in the mid lane position, it's really easy to get distracted with some of the names we have out there. You have Jensen, who's always made a splash. You have the title written Bjergsen. You have the MasterCard Player of the Week Froggen from week one. But where do you personally feel that you stack up in the mid lane?
I think for now, it's fair to say that I'm the best. I think for now, I do feel like in playoffs, Jensen usually plays really well. And I mean, we saw it last year, right? In finals, he kind of outclassed me, I guess. So I think if we win the split, then I can officially say that I'm the best. But I feel like it's really fair to say that right now, at this moment, I'm the best, yeah.
But the crazy thing is, we're hearing that sentiment not just from you on your team, but so many of your teammates. So having that individual performance work so well for each of you as a collective, what kind of empowerment does that offer you as a team?
I mean, it kind of offers the fact that even if one guy ends, like the other side of the map can carry, or like, for example, if I end, then Licorice will carry, and then it's just vice versa, right? So I think we can just carry from every role, which is really insane, I think. And yeah, that's it.
So the message is, if you run into him and have him on your team during solo queue, feel free to int because he's got your back. But for more on the breakdown of this game, let's send it over to the State Farm Analyst Desk.
Thank you, Latigris. Niski thinks he's the best mid laner in the league, and I would agree.
Me too.
Agreed. Number one.
You gave him 10.
Probably.
Wait, you guys gave one out of 10?
You think he's the worst?
No.
No. 10
out of 10, 10 points.
Oh. We've been out of sync all day, my friend.
He's first place.
Yeah, we go one, you go 10. We go 10, you go one.
10 is first place in points.
Sir, we got some work to do on our synergy. Cloud9, still undefeated. 6-0 now stands this squad. I mean, is anyone going to be able to take him down?
I hope so. This will be boring if they're winning everything. I hope they fall, but
I like watching the 18-0 team.
I think it's really cool to watch a team operate the way they do, the explosiveness that they play with. These aren't slow, drag-out games. They're decisive victories in a lot of cases.
Yeah, no, once they get a little bit, they can take it a really like long way, and I think Niski did that a lot this game. We can kind of talk about that later, where he actually makes this big play, and it kind of snowballs the entire map.
And we were hypothesizing around how Dignitas was going to be able to win this game. One of the ways we thought about was maybe a slower approach with a control mage and Huni's gangplank top. And that's actually what they went with.
Yeah.
And I think it was a decent idea, but it's just so hard to contain C9 when things start rolling. And like you're saying, any mistake you make has such large spillover consequences.
Yeah, let's take a look at that early game, because exactly as you mentioned, Dignitas going to try and slow the roll, right? Keep the pace of the game slow.
No.
But that means Cloud9 has full permission to go ham.
Yeah, I mean, this was a whoopsie by Grig. I think he knew they didn't have prio, but you know, obviously Niski's playing really well, so he can get that bubble.
Yeah, and then afterwards, it's just like the Niski blabber show where they're all over the map. They're going top now that they have control. Grig's like, okay, I'll come help cover. Then he has to blow his.
That's two flashes right there that are blown for Cloud9 for very little resources. It really was. It was just all over the map. And all while this is happening, you'll notice Niski much more a part of these fights than his counterpart in Froggen.
Yeah, this is probably the big game-breaking play. The minions are actually even in the mid lane, and Niski just leaves to come by. And if they do not get this kill on Aframu, the game is totally different. But after this, they force this Herald play because they get Cryobot, they get the swap first. Blabber happens to hit six before Grig, so he actually gets a fight off of this. And this is, I mean, I'm gonna say it again, I think this is the start of Niski's roam, was the start of all these plays.
And it was interesting too to kind of track how they all came about, because like probably saying, these are not necessarily roams where Froggen always could have followed. I think there were a number of times where if you look, someone else actually pushed Niski's wave, and it's kind of like they're unlocking each other to make these plays. We saw Aatrox take it once or twice from Licorice, then we saw Blabber take it. And so people are stealing Niski's CS so that he can have this high of a jump of proximity.
He's 41 CS down at 15 minutes, but he's only 60 gold down because of his three kills and assists in that early 15, plus turret plates and everything. 38.5% team proximity, so time spent around his team in that first 15 minutes, as compared to Froggen, who is about 15 percentage points lower in that category. So just two totally different play styles. Yeah. Froggen going to sit mid and farm, Niski going to play the map. The map won.
But I do think this is one of those times where I don't think it's Froggen's fault that he got out roam, because he would push and get what should be a good back.
Yeah.
And then instead of like having Niski go under the turret and catch it, the jungler would just come and kill the wave, and then Niski would go somewhere else and would never need to go mid. It was really impressive to see.
Yeah, they kept up the pressure really well, where it wasn't like, you know, it's my turn to roam and now it's your turn next. It was like, it's pretty much Niski roams and then Froggen's like still catching stuff.
Right.
So it was really weird to see it, but it was I was really happy this was what broke up the game, was the fact that Niski was actually able to get that roam off, because that swap that happens later, the Herald fight that happens there with all those deaths where Blabber gets the kill, that was literally started by Niski leaving an even wave. That's the weird thing. If you rewatch that replay, it's five versus five minions just fighting.
In the mid lane.
In the mid lane. And Niski just pieces. He just runs out, and Froggen's sitting there like,
right,
this is our lane, buddy.
That is a scary decision for a mid laner to make, right?
Oh, he's, you know, Froggen's
to know that if I come away with nothing there,
the
what I have wasted in leaving the mid lane with those minions up could be disastrous for my team. But he's got the faith that if he delivers to his bot or his top side, that as he said in that interview, anyone on that team is capable of carrying. It does bring us to our final replay here of the day. Sven's first death, it has to be watched.
Yeah.
I was so happy about this.
You saw Froggen have to flash in to punish because Sven's positioning is good. And if you dare kill their boy Sven.
Do not kill Sven because your whole team dies.
Then you made C9 angry.
Yeah, there's three flashes that come in to chase Dig after that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I want to know what the comms were like in that moment, you know?
But it was good because Froggen sees like Aatrox behind him and he's like,
I'm still doing it.
But there's Finn without Flash right there. Like, see you later, guys. I'm flashing in.
I mean, at that point, what was the goal difference? It was like 8K. It was like Infernal Drake's
goal. I respect it. It was the assassination attempt.
He's like, you know what? We're probably going to lose this game.
It was exactly what Crumbs was saying yesterday. He's like, if I were in a game against Cloud9 in the future, I would waste everything I have at my disposal just to get Sven on the death board. But that's only his first one.
He's got one more to play with.
Exactly. He's got one more that he has to pick up before it halves his KDA. So I think he's up near about 60 now, because it was a low kill game, and it was 51 plus he got about 7 or so added to
that. Well, he was at 51 at the start of the week, and then he had like 12, and then he got like 6 more or something. So I think he's up to like 70.
Oh, maybe he's
got like 2 more weeks of kills.
Maybe we should just let the stats people tell us these
things
instead of, you know,
speculate wildly,
making up numbers and hoping that we're correct. It's time for us to take a break, but after the commercial, it's Evil Geniuses versus FlyQuest. Don't touch that browser.
Oh, bubble does land.
There we go. They're looking to go in. Grig taken out, making sure no more damage is coming in. Blabber's found the Sonic Wave. Kick into the Resonating Strike. Good Lord, man. Grig is gone. Shelly is stolen.
I'm dead. Oh, no flash.
I'm dead.
Or is that
too? It's fine. It's good.
Yeah. They're all dead. Kill the
guy. Vulcan's gonna buy some time for these guys. He's got the stone plate, keeping him tanky. They're on the front line. Blabber goes over the wall, and he is unstoppable.
We're finishing tower?
Yeah.
Nice. I'm fine. Nice. On next side.
DPM.
Here in spring 2020, Cloud9, they are 6-0.
So Josh, you going for our Drive Safe and Safe discount?
Yep, using the app, driving safe.
You wanna go, bro?
Do not mess with my discount.
Get a discount up to 30% with Drive Safe and Save.
When you're chasing greatness, just remember, it's not about what you say, it's about what you do.